I want to continue what I started last week, talking about attracting the commanded blessing of God. And I want to pick up where we left off. I'm gonna do good tonight. Okay, in John chapter 14, this is an amplified version of the Bible. I like using this because it amplifies what the other versions don't. As you remember, if you were here, we talked about attracting the commanded blessing of God. The first thing we have to do is position ourselves. I have to be where God wants me to be. I have to position myself. And one of the ways to position myself is following Him, following God, following Jesus. And Jesus said in John 14, 21, the person who has my commands and keeps them is the one who really loves me. And whoever really loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him. And I will reveal and do what else? Manifest. That was the word we pulled out. Manifest myself to him. What does that mean, Jesus? I will let myself be clearly seen by him and make myself real to him. And so we talked about that. If I'm going to get in a place where I command, attract the command blessing of God, I have to follow him. I have to follow him. And following him means that I'm going to be and do what he said do. I can't follow somebody if I don't follow what they're saying. And so he says, you know, a lot of times people say, oh, I love God, I love God. You don't love God. I'm talking about anybody here, but you don't love God if you don't obey his word. God defines love. A lot of times we want to define stuff that God says, but God said, you love me if you follow my word. Now, you can just say you're interested in him. If you're not going to follow his word, just say, I'm interested in God. But don't say you love him. Say he's a nice guy or something, but don't say you love him if you're not going to obey him. And he said, the person that obeys me, I will make myself real to him. And remember, we talked about having the real Jesus. Yes. The real Jesus, the Jesus of the Bible. Amen. Not some, you know, there's all kind of Jesuses out there, but the Jesus of the Bible, the Jesus that calmed the storm. The Jesus that brings Jairus' daughter back to life. The Jesus that paid the taxes when we don't know where the money going to come from. And he said, just relax, go fishing. We talking about Jesus, y'all. We talking about the Jesus that speak to dead people and call them out. I mean, think about it. Jesus stood out there and called the man, and he had to call his name because everybody would have come bouncing out of them. He said, Lazarus, I'm concerned about your sisters out here bugging me, man. And so I got to quiet them down. So get up out of that cave. Amen. We're talking about Jesus, the real Jesus. The real Jesus said, I will never, ever leave you or forsake you. The same Jesus who said, whatever you ask the Father in my name, I'll do that for you. That Jesus is the one we're talking about. The one who says, listen, he said, listen, if you bind the devil, whatever you bound is bound. That Jesus we're talking about. Real Jesus. Real Jesus. Okay. And so we said that, I don't know about you. Yes, I do. We want to see the real Jesus, don't we? Yes. You know, because, you know, we log a lot of time in, and Jesus wants to be manifested because there's a world that doesn't know him. They don't know him. They won't read the Bible. You know, always add, it's hard enough to get the saint to read it. I'm appalled and amazed how many people don't. You talking? You read? Wow. This is your life, man. Amen. This is your life. Amen. You can't survive as a believer not reading this. Amen. You can't. You can't. You cannot. Okay. I'm reviewing. Let me get back to the thing here. Okay. So he the real Jesus. Now, I want you to go to Isaiah 41 now because, no, don't go there. Yeah, you can go there. No, you don't go there. Don't go there. I said I was going to do this. I'll talk through this one. Now, we said that many people want manifestation, but they won't position themselves, right? And so last time, one of the things we said was that the commanded blessing, if I want to have it, I have to avoid distractions. And we don't go here, but in Hebrews 12:1-2, it says, lay aside every weight and every sin that does beset you or sets you back or slow your progress. And I talked to Brother Steve last time, and he had a great illustration. He always comes up and summarizes my sermon and corrects everything I do wrong. No, but he made an illustration. I said, man, I should have thought of that. But because I have a weight vest, you know, weight vest, and you work out, you put the weight on, and make your heart work harder and you know, all that. And I said, man, that's exactly what it's like, because you're moving, but you can't go as fast. You're moving, but you're wearing out. And that's the way it is. He said, see, and it's not distraction. Distractions are designed to slow you down or entangle you to where you can't make any progress. And so he said, strip all of that. Strip that stuff off. Strip off the weight. Strip off the sin. And because you're trying to move somewhere and you can't go there with all of that baggage and garbage on you. So let it go. I think you better let it go. You better what?
Let it go.
You gotta let it go. Because if I don't, I can easily get ensnared by distractions. And we said a distraction is anything or anyone, you know, that pulls my attention away from God. Because he said, lay aside every weight and every distraction. I like amplify this, every unnecessary weight. Okay, I want to move on. And he said, looking away from all that distracts, looking unto Jesus. And so we want to work with that tonight, looking unto Jesus. We have to stay focused on Jesus. The reason why people get caught up is that they lose focus. You know how I feel about focus, and the slight distraction can get you off. And if you get off a little, you know, a long time, you get way off. And that's the way the enemy works. He doesn't come in, you know, just try to overwhelm you. It's just a little by little. And see, even while I'm talking about this, I'm asking God to help all of us recognize, okay, you know what, I'm off a little bit. Let me make some corrections right now. Because that's designed to take me so far off that I can't even reach for Jesus. Y'all remember when Peter got distracted walking on the water?
Yeah.
The Bible said he Jesus reached and got him. He wasn't that far off, but he got distracted and started sinking. I don't want to be so far off that Jesus can't got to send a crane out there to pull me back in. So a lot of time, little by little, it doesn't take a lot. And sometimes we don't recognize, wow, you know, I'm being played right now. Look away from all that distracts. Now, I want to look at another word. This came to me as I was reviewing. So I'm going to go to Isaiah 41. I'm using the Amplified again. Isaiah 41, because this speaks to where we're going tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Throw aside every weight. You know, and weights can be something, not sin. It's just something that I'm putting too much attention on. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We live in a time now. Listen, we need God, man. We don't need to be so casual and so caught up that we don't hear God. And it's something. Okay, Isaiah 41:10 Amplified. If you don't have Amplified, look up on the screen because I really want you to see this. This is powerful. He says, "Fear not," God speaking. This is God's love letter to you. Fear not. There is what? Why? For I am with you. Do not look around you in terror and be dismayed. For I am your God. Well, I'm going to read it through, and then I'm going to read it like this is one of my daily meditation scriptures. It is. I read this every day. I read this these three, 11, 12, and 13, every day. But I'm going to read through, and then I'm going to come back and get dramatic. For I am your God. I will strengthen and harden you to difficulties. Yes, I will help you. Yes, I will hold you up and retain you with my victorious right hand of rightness and justice. Now look at verse 11. Behold, all they who are enraged and inflamed against you. Anybody got anybody coming against them, talking a bunch of noise? Against you shall be put to shame and confounded. They're going to be like, hey, what just happened? They who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. You shall seek those who contend with you, but you're going to be like, hey, what happened to them folks that was causing all them problems? You can't find them. They who war against you shall be as nothing at all. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. You know, when Mayweather won that fight, Kenny Bayless, that's the referee, said, champion, victorious, unanimous decision. That's what God said I got for you. Amen. I don't care, your eye may be bugged. You can't even look around. You stand. You got the tar beat out of you. God is still raising your hand and saying, you got the victory. I don't care how long the bout was or how long the war was. At the end, he's gonna raise your hand. Okay, let's go back. Let's go back because I want some points I want you to get. Tonight is breakthrough night. I said tonight is breakthrough night. Now, remember what we said in Hebrews 12. He said, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. So my focus got to be God, right? Okay, now, fear not. There is nothing to fear, for I am with you. Watch this. Do not look around. God, he said, don't look around in terror and dismay, paranoid, scared, troubled, worried, agitated, nervous in the service. And uneasy, he said, don't be dismayed, don't be nervous, don't be troubled, agitated. Why? I am your God. Yes. He said, don't be looking around, oh my God, what's going to happen? What are these people doing? What did they say over there on what they say on TV? He said, quit all of that. I'm your God. Yes. You look at me. Keep your eyes on me. Teacher. I'm your God. Yes. They're not your God. That job is not your God. The president's not your God. The government's not your job. I'm your God. I'm the only one that can take care of you. That man is not your God. That woman is not your God. I'm your God. What you worried about? Can I have a good time tonight? I just feel like preaching. Sometimes you just feel like preaching. You know what I'm saying? Now, this is my, no, he said, I'm your God. I don't care what they say. I don't care what kind of threat they got. I'm your God. I know you got the MRI or the, what is that, the MRI? I know you got the MRI. I know that you got the biopsy. I know what the man in the white coat said, but. Okay, come on, work with me now. Work with me. Y'all did good. They did good. We didn't have practice. We didn't have practice, but we're going to do it again. I know the man with the white coat said this, but.
I'm your God.
Woo! That's my church right there. That's the church I pastor right there. That's,
yeah. I know that thing right there on your chest is bumping out. I know you can't sleep at night, but don't you look over there. You look at me because
I'm your God.
We gotta stay focused, man. We got to stay focused on Jesus. We all, listen, we all got something we're going through right now. We all got something that's trying to come in and pressure us and put us down in the corner. But I got the one more thing to say. I'm going to look at it and say what?
I'm your God.
Thank you,
sir. That's what I'm talking about right there.
I'm serious. I'm your God. He said, don't be looking around. What you looking around for? Don't be get scared.
Don't be dismayed. You don't need a drink of fifth right now. I got something else to calm your nerves. Ooh, they did work on my nerve, Pastor. Well, God said, open. God said, anyway. I'm your God. And watch this. And then he said, look at it again. I will do what? I will strengthen you. I feel so weak. I'm your God. I will strengthen you. And watch this. I will harden you to difficulties. See, now we're talking about keeping our eyes on Jesus, man. We're talking about keeping our focus on God. And the things are coming to distract us, to get my mind off of God and off of the Word. And that's what we're talking about. See, the more I can stay focused on Jesus, he'll strengthen me. He'll harden me to difficulties. You know what that means? My wife took me to the movies the other day. She took me, it was a labor of love. She like all this stuff. We went to see the Avengers. In the name of Jesus, I just. But you know, I told her, because I knew she was going to ask me after the movie. So what'd you think of the movie? So I'm sitting there getting my commentary together, because I know, because if I, you know, the average man answer is what? It's all right. But that wasn't going to work. So I sat there for 2 hours, praise the Lord. But anyway, so I gave up, I spiritualized everything. But one thing I thought about, though, that boy, Iron Man, I'm like, I thought about that when the Bible said he will harden us to difficulty. That boy got hit with everything. He kept his cool in his little world. Just kept his cool and stayed kept focused. God will harden you. He never said you're not gonna have problems. You're not gonna have challenges. He never said that. He never fooled us thinking, well, you get saved. People tell you that they lying. I'm telling you, they lying. You're gonna have more problems than you ever thought you could have after you get saved. Because the devil trying to get you back into his league. And so, but hard, God said, what God is telling you, God said, you're going to get hit, but I'm going to harden you to it, to where it doesn't crush you. It used to crush you every time you got a little plap. But see, now, the more you focus on me and you focus on my word, you're going to get hard. You're going to get hard. And what used to take you out, you're going to be like, you know what I'm saying? You know, you're not going to fall to your knees anymore. You're just going to like, pie out, whatever. Is that it? Is that the best shot? Because you can harden to it. And then when you understand that every time I blink it off, I'm getting strong because he'll strengthen me. Because he's strengthening me because I'm going somewhere. Now, if I let the blow knock me out, I won't get to where God is trying to take me. So he said, keep your eyes on me. I'll strengthen you. And then, see, strengthen is one thing. Being hardened is another thing. Amen. I'm your God. Amen. Shoot. And see, he said, I'm your God. He said, you don't have to run to anybody else. I'm your God. He said in the New Testament, he said, you come up among them, I'll be a God to you. A God means a God can do anything. Okay, Jesus. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will harden you to difficulty. Yes, what else? Yes, I will. No, you forgot. You missed the part. That's the biggest one in there. Yes, I will help you. I will help you. Well, Pastor, you don't know what I did to get in this mess. He didn't ask you what you did. He said, I'll help you. Yeah. Glory to God. Say this with me. Lord,
thank you
for helping me. Now, whatever you thinking about, whatever you were thinking about, you came in, I want you to know something. You got help. You got help. Right now. Not after you fast 21 days. You got help right now. Sitting on your blessed assurance. You got help right now. There may be something going on back in Tallahassee, but I want you to know something. You got help. Shoot. You may be walking to a courtroom tomorrow. I know you got a high-powered attorney, but I want you to know something else. You got some help that's working tonight. Because he knows how to make a man run when ain't nobody chasing him. What do you mean by that? He knows how to get in folks' thoughts and they like change their mind. I'm talking about we got a God that knows how to do some reversals. Boy, I'm feeling this thing tonight, man. I might just go on and get Baptist on y'all. Okay, no, there ain't nothing wrong with being Baptist, but I am Baptist. I'm all kind of the Baptist, Methodist, Lutheran. Oh, I'm everything. Okay, let me finish this scripture. I will strengthen and harden you to difficulty. Yes, I will help you. Yes, I will hold you up and retain you with my victorious right hand of rightness and justice. Now, what I wanted to think about, what I want to pull out is, he said, don't look around you. I am with you. We can't discount God's presence. And we can't discount God's presence. And when is he with us? I don't know if we talked about this before. He's with me all the time. He's not just with me when I come to church during the praise service. He's with me when I'm at the stoplight. And he loves fellowshipping with me. I was telling my staff this morning. I said, you know, sometimes we just think prayer is just making stuff coming out of our mouth. But prayer is communion. God wants you to just relax sometimes. He wants to talk. You ever talk to somebody on the phone and they just talking, then you just put the phone down. You just put it down. Every now and then you're like, yeah, you know, you put it on mute, they don't even know you're gone. They just talking away, and you're like, whatever, let me go on it anyway. Jesus. But God's like, just fellowship, we just talk. The Bible said he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or what else. So he's in your thought. There's a scripture in Psalm that talks about how your meditation is prayer. So you just think. Sometimes if you got a problem, just say, Lord, you know, I wanna shut everything out. I just wanna think. I did that just this morning, and God gave me like five things to fix it. Just five things. I'm just sitting there thinking. I thought, I'm gonna just think right now. I'm serious. And bam, bam, bam. A lot of times, when was the last time you got really quiet and just thought? Just thought. Lord, you know, my baby, you know, she got this rash that keeps showing up. What do you think I ought to do? And then just sit there and wait and get the answer. And especially if you pray in other tongues, the Bible says you pray in mystery. If you be quiet long enough, the wisdom of God will float into your consciousness. All right. Now, I want give me Hebrews 13:5. Okay, I gotta get on. I'm setting you up. Hebrews 13:5. Give me half of it. I just start where it says, for he God. I don't know if you can do that. For he God. Okay, yeah. Right in the middle. I just want to emphasize this verse. For he God. For he God himself has said, I will not in any way fail you, nor give you up, nor leave you without support. I will not. I will not. He's not seen now. He just wants you to know, I will not in any degree leave you what? Helpless. Nor forsake, nor let you down, nor relax my hold on you. Assuredly not. This is the one who said, I'm your God. This is the one who said, I will strengthen you, I will harden you, I will take care of you. But now he's telling us, I'm not ever going to leave you. I'm not ever going to forsake you. I'm not ever going to leave you without support. I will not, I will not, I will not. I can't do that. Now, people will walk out on you. People will make pleasure to you and turn right around 3 weeks later and act like they never had that conversation. But I will not let you down. I won't ever forget what you've done for me. I won't ever forget what you've done in my name. I've written a book. I got a book of remembrance written with every time you talked about me. I'm not going to let you down. Nothing escaped my attention. I know people may not applaud you. They may not even show appreciation for what you did. But I did, and I was not only... See, sometimes when you're going through and having a pity party, you need to read this one right here. Because God's presence is so real. Now, say, God supports me. Say that with me.
God supports me.
He's with me right now.
He's with me right now.
And he'll never
leave me
without support.
Y'all
remember when Peter was falling in the water? He was sinking. And Jesus did what? He reached out and saved him. Even though Peter lost his way, even though Peter, you know, he was walking and Peter cried out, Jesus still reached out with support and saved him. Sometimes we just got a bad impression of God, but God is good, even when we're not good. He's just saying, listen, just holler. Not like holler, but holler. You need me to save you? Yes, holler. Save me, Jesus. That's what I was waiting on. Come on. All right. And I like the scripture said immediately he reached out. Now, there's a couple other guys. These are familiar stories. I'm not going to turn to all of them. But there's a couple other people, because I want to show you God will never leave you. There was a couple guys by the name of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And we know that they walked in the midst of the fiery furnace, right? And they were totally unhurt, totally unhurt. And then the Bible says that there was, when the people threw him in there, they saw a fourth person who looked like the Son of God in the midst of the fire. Where were they at? But they all walked out, didn't they?
Yes.
Now, here's pressure. See, some of y'all already right in, you in the fire now. See, a lot of times we like to get delivered from the fire. But sometimes God deliver us has to deliver us out of the fire. See, we want to get to the door and have him deliver us. Woo, thank God. You know what I'm saying? And we don't want to go through stuff. And I understand that nobody does. There's something wrong with you if you want to keep going through the fire. But there's times you got to go through the fire. Because, you know, if you read that story, that nothing, the only thing that got burnt when they went through the fire was the stuff that, was the rope that they tied to bind them up. And sometimes you got to go through the fire so you can get the stuff burnt off of you that's holding you back, that's holding you from where God is trying to take you. And God's like, I've been trying to tell you, but you're going to have to go through that fire and let that fire burn off them ropes. I'm trying to take you somewhere. I sent Friendly down there to tell you, but you won't listen to him. So anyway. No, sometimes the only thing that got burned was what was binding them up. And God said, listen, I got so much. Lighthouse, he said, I got so much for you right now. I got so much for you. But you got to go through the fire. Because that's the only way I can burn this stuff off of you. I got a whole kingdom available for you. I got dreams and future for you that you can't even imagine. But it's something just holding you back right now. I don't know if it's that relationship. I don't know if it's something, the mindset you have. But will you let me... I said, see, that's why I took you to all that way. See, I'll be with you. I won't let you down. Even in the fire. Even in the fire, he's still supporting us. In the fire, he's still being there for us, man. And we got to let him purify some stuff and burn it off of us. Man. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He's walking through the midst of that with us. Man, see, sometimes we forget God is with me. When you're in the midst of the fire, that's when you need to praise God the most. Yeah. Lord, I know you're in here with me. Yeah. I really believe.
I really believe it is not always the devil when we have unpleasant things happening. And a lot of times I think God allows you to go through things not because of what you've done, but because of where you're going. Because you're that next level, you can't handle that with that character flaw. And there's nothing that'll humble you. There's nothing that'll humble you like failure. There's nothing that'll humble you like a good I sure would want to say that. There's nothing that'll humble you like a good butt whooping. I never forget. Germany. I was in Germany, and this marked me though. It marked me for the rest of my life. I was playing on the varsity team, basketball team, and the year before, one year I was playing, and you know, we had a team. I was like the dude to come off the bench and just score. That's all I did was just shoot and score. You know, I had a jumper. And so I was like downtown Freddie Brown. Some of y'all know who that is, some of you don't. Okay, well, that was my job. My job was to come in and then just shoot and score. Well, there was a guy who came on the team after we had played about 5 or 6 games, right? And then all of a sudden, he moved in front of me. I'm like, what is up with that? And then, you know, I was all Europe in baseball, so I had a big name. You know, everybody thought they thought I was something. And I did too. But you know, I'm all you safety, all Europe, right? And so, and I had started, people were like, Friendly, what's up with that, man? How come this so-and-so stealing your minutes? I was like, I don't know. Then I found out why. The coach was his Masonic Lodge brother. Oh, okay. Okay. All right, that's all I need to say about that. And so I'm like, okay, all right, okay, just like that, huh? And so I quit the team. I'm saying, let's see how they do without me. So I quit the team, right? Okay. So I'm fast forward next year, got a new coach. I said, oh, let me go on back out there. And so I went back out there, and, you know, we had to, you know, tryouts and everything. I'm like, okay, this is formality, because everybody knew I had skills. And so they, you know, and then they post the team up on the, you go to the gym during the day, they have it on the board who made the team. So I went over there. I'm going to just go on over there. I'm just going over there, because, you know, I know I'm on the team. And so I went over there, I'm like, F? Maybe they got an F, maybe they got it under K. And my name wasn't on the list. I didn't make the team. Now I'm the best guard on the base. So I knew the coach. I said, hey, coach, you forget my name? He said, no, I didn't select you. You didn't make it. I wasn't saved then. I wasn't saved. I wasn't saved right then. So I said a couple of things to him, you understand. And he said, this is what he said. Mark me for the rest of my life. Mark me even to this day. He said, you quit on the last coach. Yep. And he said, I don't want no quitters on my team. I say, I'm the best thing on the... You're a quitter. I'd rather lose than have somebody I can't depend on that might quit as soon as he don't get his way. That's what he told me. That was 1979. To this day, that marked me. Because, see, your character, that's a character flaw, quitting, because I didn't get my way. Your character will go ahead of you and speak. And so that's why a lot of times, what was I trying to say about that? Oh, how God, sometimes you got to go through something. And so, I talking about how stuff will humble you. That humbled me. I said, man, I'm labeled as a quitter? Everybody think I'm a quitter? Did you tell anybody this? So I became known as a quitter. People don't like to deal with quitters. So it humbled me, and I went back to him, and I said, man, you know, I appreciate that. I hadn't quit anything since.
Y'all know I got a lot of series on Never Quit. That's why I got all that. Because when you quit, you tip your hand to the devil. And he knows what it takes to get you to quit the next time. And it doesn't matter whether you quit your girlfriend or quit God. He knows how to get you to quit. He knows how to keep pressure on you and how to just keep it on you. Sometimes it's not so intense, but it's just steady. Okay, let me move on. So, what was I talking about? Okay. I was talking about them three Hebrew boys, right? Okay. Oh, how only thing got burnt off of them was that that thing that bound them up. And I believe God used that. That's what got burnt off of me, because he knew where I was going or where he wanted me to go. That, and I couldn't be in this. I'd have quit this a long time ago. I'd have quit this after about 6 months if I still had that quitting spirit. So, okay. Okay, so they were unhurt. Now, in the battle, we have things that bind us or keep us from what God wants us to be. But in this story, and it's a great story, but what do we learn from it? We have to learn that, like these three Hebrew boys, we need to know our God and the kind of God that he is. What do you mean, Pastor? He's a good God. And he will support us. He never leaves us no matter what we're going through. It was their relationship with God that brought them out of this. It was their relationship with God that didn't have them cave in to intimidation. And this is what I'm talking about. They kept their eyes on God, even though all the situation, even though the contradictory circumstances and situations would totally look like, oh, this is over, man. You better bow. And they say, well, we'll heat the furnace up seven times hotter. And you better bow. They say, we will not bow to intimidation. We're not going to serve anybody else or anything else but our God. Lighthouse, we got to make a determination. I'm not serving anything else or anybody else but Almighty God. I'm talking about having the manifested presence. This is how you position yourself for the manifested presence of God. There needs to be a resolve. I'm not serving anything else. Ain't nobody going to steal me and take me from God's presence. I'm serving God for the rest of my day. If I got to serve him riding a moped, I'm going to serve him because he's still good. Shoot. And so that was they positioned themselves. Say they positioned themselves. Okay. Now I want you to go here. I want to go to Joshua chapter 10. Hallelujah. Oh my God. I'll tell you what, man, I got fired up looking at this. So when we get this kind of relationship with him, we have no desire to serve anything else. I'm gonna bring this church back to serving God first, man. I say, I'm gonna bring this thing back, man. It's gonna be Jesus first and nothing else. Jesus is enough. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay, now this is an awesome, awesome story, but I'm trying to make a point that God is good, and when you position yourself, I'm gonna show you what he can do. In Joshua chapter 10, beginning with verse 12, this is where God supported Joshua in a battle. And verse 12 says, then Joshua spoke to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, son, who was he talking to? He said, son, stand over there. Stand still over Gibeon. And then he spoke to the moon in the valley of somewhere. Verse 13. So the sun did what? And the moon did what? Till the people revenged upon their enemies. So he's saying, Joshua, like, God needs the day to stop. You know, now NASA's still looking for that day. Because they're saying there's a day missing out of this universe right now. It's really, I know where it is. Joshua got it. anyway. So here's the thing. Joshua had the sun stand still and the moon stand still until to give him enough time to take out his enemy. Isn't that wonderful? God did that. Now watch this. Okay, verse 13 again. So the sun stood still and the moon stopped till the people revenged upon their enemies. Is this not written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and did not hasten to go down for about a whole day. And there has been no day like that before it or after it. Watch this. That the Lord heeded the voice of a man. For the Lord fought for Israel. Now this is the same God who said, I won't ever leave you. I won't leave you without support. I will strengthen you. I will harden you to difficulty. Same God. Now why are you telling us this? Well, hold on, because I'm going to get to my point, my punchline in a minute. But I want you to see, God did this for a man. Now, they had an inferior covenant. They didn't even have a covenant as good as ours. Joshua's covenant wasn't good as ours. The three Hebrew boys didn't have a covenant like ours. They were servants. We're sons. We're heirs of God, joint heirs with Jesus. Okay, I thought you might have been a little bit excited about that. What was it about these guys that attracted these kind of manifestations? For the next few minutes, I want to talk about that. What was it? Pastor, how come some Christians like, wow, they're so solid, they're so, they go through things like everything, but they seem like they always just come out. And there's no shadow of turning in them. They don't take off for 6 months and then you don't see them and then they don't get quiet. You know, some of y'all just get quiet. I ain't talking to nobody. After that, y'all suck, Bell, but y'all keep a brother praying. Yeah, I mean it's an anyway. But here's my question: how come some see exploits and some never have a testimony? Y'all want to know? Now you might want to get up and leave before I tell you, because once I tell you, you're gonna be accountable. So I wait. Okay, we got one leaving now. No, I know she. I'm just playing. She not leaving. I know she ain't leaving because she ain't away. Let me make sure I tell you that because she'll be like, "What that man say?" Okay. All right. Okay, y'all all about to be accountable. It's all good though. It's good. Now. Give me Daniel 6, please. What was it about these guys? Now, even Daniel, let's read it. Hallelujah, Jesus. Daniel 6, verse 3 says this. Then this Daniel distinguished himself above the governors and the satrap because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king gave thought to setting him over the whole realm. Now, Daniel did what? What was it about these guys that caused them to have the kind of testimony that we read? Because we know that Daniel, they tried to frame him, the people at work, everybody, he had a whole government against him. And they told him, you can't pray no more. You can't pray. He said, man, please. You know what he said, right? He said, he opened up the window. And he opened that window and he just started praying as loud as he could. The Bible said, in fact, it's in Daniel. Daniel's the one that said, he said, they who know their God shall be strong and do exploits. What causes some people to have manifestations and victory and other people, they just go to church? Now, what I'm about to say, I'm going to show you why. But what I'm about to say, I just want to qualify it. Now, if all you want to do is be saved and go to heaven when you die, and, you know, just kind of control your own shots and live the way you want to live on the earth. What I'm about to say, and God will receive you in the heaven. He'll love you. He still loves you. But you won't see any of these manifestations like I'm talking about. Because these manifestations, the Bible said Daniel distinguished himself. You know what that means? He didn't look like everybody else. His behavior, he didn't talk like everybody else. He didn't praise like everybody else. He lived with the purpose that I'm glorifying God. He lived with the purpose that, you know, I'm gonna know God, and I know him so well, I'm not serving anybody else. Nobody else can cause me to break away from God, and I'm living for him in such a way that I'm gonna do some extra. There's gonna be some differences in my life. I'm not gonna be like everybody else in this department. Something different is gonna be on my life, and not only am I gonna say it, but they're gonna see it. And the Bible says that there was an excellent spirit on him, and they promoted him throughout the whole realm. So what I'm about to say is, if you want manifestation, you want to see Jesus manifesting in your life, if you want to see the exploits of God, you're going to have to be different. Amen. This is not for the casual believer. And I know, and it's okay, God still love you, and it's okay, but I got to preach the hundredfold. I thought y'all might have been excited about that. Okay. Now, you're excited about it? Okay, look at this. Now, go to Numbers chapter 14. You know, I'm not going to read all these scriptures. I just want to give you a couple of things. I'm going to read them. You can read them on your own time, because these are very familiar scriptures. But I'm telling you what was different. Numbers 14:24, look on the board if you don't know where Numbers is. He said, but my servant Caleb, because he has a different from who? A different spirit in him, and has followed me fully, I will bring into the land where he went, and his descendants shall inherit it. Now, those of you that know, if you go back and read number 13, you know, God promised the land. He said, I'm giving you this land. I'm giving it to you. And he sent 10 spies out there. Remember? Joshua and Caleb were two of the spies. Yep. And the long and short of it is, Joshua and Caleb went in, and their children inherited the land. How come the other 10 didn't go in? How come the other 10 didn't go in? Because they were too busy trying to be like everybody else. See, Joshua and Caleb said, see, that's why God said he got a different spirit. Man, if we're going to live this thing, if we're going to see exploits, if we're going to see the grace of God abound in a mighty way, we're going to have a different spirit. We're going to have to, we can't just fit into the mold that everybody else is, or the mold that people say Christians ought to be. I tell you, I don't know about you, but my standard comes from the word of God. He said, they shall lay hands on the sick, the ship shall recover, with long life I'll satisfy you and show you my salvation. No evil shall befall you, no plague shall come near your dwelling. Great is the peace of my children. That's the standard. So I'm not blending in like the other 10. The other 10 never went in. In fact, they died in the wilderness. Why? Because they decided. They heard the same thing Joshua and Caleb heard. They saw the same thing Joshua and Caleb saw. But somehow, somebody got to make a decision. Man, I'm preaching good. Somebody got to make a decision. Now, this is for everybody in here, because God can do this for anybody who wants it. He pours water on the thirsty. But somebody got to make a decision. Deb and I made a decision a long time ago. Like, we're not going to be like everybody else. We're not going to be normal. We're not going to be normal. We're not going to grow old like a whole lot of people, aches and pains. That ain't happening. That is not happening. No, we make some decisions. Because the Bible tells us, with Moses, he said, as his days are, so shall your strength be. Yes. With me, as long as you're on the earth, you can be, you can do all of that. Yes. You can do all of that. Right. Me and Jim were talking today. Because Jim get ready to get his gold wing next week. He get ready to get and you know, Jim turned 65 the other day. And he said, man, shoot. I said, well, you don't look like you're slowing down. He said, ain't no slow down in the Bible. No slow down in the Bible. See, a lot of times we just, can I talk to you? A lot of times we just accept stuff because everybody else is doing it. We look at people, we compare them. Well, you know, my mama, that ain't got nothing to, I'm going to just scream. I don't care. That ain't got nothing to do with me right now. I got a new bloodline. I'm in a new family. I'm royalty. And my daddy promised me some stuff. 2 Corinthians tells us it's not wise to compare ourselves among ourselves. Not my standard. I made some decisions. I ain't gonna tell you because y'all be like, that man crazy. But I ain't gonna even verbalize it right here. But I'm like, no, this ain't happening. It just ain't happening to us. This ain't happening like this. No. No. I'm different. I'm being different. And I don't care who don't like it. I don't care. I got a standard. The Bible tells me some stuff. God took this man, took Caleb, and it took him a while because all the mother folks had to die. But Caleb went over at 80-something. How old was he? 80-something. He said, give me my mom. He said, I'm strong now. Didn't he say it? As I was when God promised it. Give it up. Come on. See, some of y'all are like, oh, I don't know about. See, you gotta read the Bible. You gotta believe it. The reason why people do exploits is because they're different. Now, if you just wanna get along and let everybody like you and you fit in and blend in, this ain't for you. Now you'll make it to heaven, and you know you'll like some of the sermons that I preach. Some of them. No, I say that because I'm not your average guy, and I'm not trying to put anything on me. But we choose. I'm going for the mother load.
Yes, sir.
I'm going all the way. I'd much rather come short reaching for the top than hit the bottom every time. Peter was in that boat, right? He jumped out. Didn't he walk on water?
Yes, he did.
How many other cats was in the boat? They could have walked on the water too. But he said, I'm going to be different. I'm just making a decision. And I don't care where you are. It doesn't matter where you are. You're with God now. You're with God now. Glory to God. He said, Caleb, you got a different spirit. Different spirit. Hallelujah. Yeah. Well, I don't want my folks going to think something. Let them think that. They're going to need you after a while. They're going to need some different. I got to prosper, man. I got to keep taking care of my family. You know, until they get the revelation. Praise the Lord. We got to help them. Got a Joseph thing. Okay. So if I want to see some Ephesians 3:20, I'm going to have to do something different. And I can't be afraid. Being different for God. I ain't talking about just being different. I mean for God. God, you said this is possible. You said I can have peace in the midst. I'm going for it. I know people want to talk, well, who he think he is? Why he got to do all that? Why you ain't got to pray that much? Well, you just shut up. I'm being different. I'm being different. I'm going for it. There's something in here that I got too many examples of folk doing exploit for God. I'm not blending. I don't care. I ain't trying to look like everybody else. I'm not trying to be like everybody else's preacher. I'm not trying. We ain't trying. We, you know, at a certain point of age, you're like, whatever. At a certain point of your age, you're like, whatever. I know that people come to the church like, okay, I don't know, Pastor, all right, but he started getting over there. I don't care, whatever. You tell him I said, whatever. Because the more I read this, the more radical I get. Because I'm like, well, what you say? Give me 2 Corinthians 10:12, please, on the board. I want you guys to see this. My brother ordered this series. I had it for sale. And he ordered it. And he said, "Oh my God." I said, "Yep, that's your brother." Look at it. Now this is, I'm not going to, this is what I'm talking about. We dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves. But they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise. Man, you know what that means? That means I pick one of y'all, I'm like, "Oh wow, Patricia, wow, she did this, and I guess, wow, you know, I know she loved the Lord, but okay, I guess I guess it's okay for that to be part of my life too." Or you know, so and so, people. So, but you know, so and so them was saved and they got divorced, so you know we probably gonna have a hard time. That's comparing yourself with yourself. Well, you know, your mama had this, you know, and you know, there's a report, there's a family history. Come on, God. So I'm comparing myself now to mama now. He said it's not wise. I'm going for it. And I'm going to be different in the process. I'm going to serve God if I'm the only one. If I'm the only one going for it, I'm going to serve, I'm going to pray, I'm going to fast, I'm going to give, I'm going to show mercy, I'm going to volunteer. God said the greatest, see, people don't get the power of volunteering. The Bible says the greatest among you is the servant.
Yes, sir.
Servants don't get paid. Servants don't get paid. So that's telling me volunteering can take you way beyond where your training can take you. So I'm going to serve. I'm going to do stuff for people that can't do a thing for me. Why? Because that's what God said. Because I'm going for great. Man, I ain't accepting nothing. I ain't accepting nothing that ain't in the Bible. Okay, is this too radical for you? I wrote this down. Just because others are experiencing something or not experiencing something, that has nothing to do with me. My comparison and my standard is the Bible. What did God say about it? Hallelujah. How many folks in here tonight? You're going to make a decision. You're not going to compare yourself with some other human being. You're going to compare yourself with what God said. Your home. Okay, that's we got work to do. That's only about 7-8 people. But see, your home don't have to be like that. If you just got married, you don't have to have 2 years of hell. You don't have to buy into that. Thank you, Jesus. When your child become 2, you don't have to have terrible 2s. Shoot. You don't. No, we just compare ourselves with ourselves. No, there's certain things that just don't have to, but we bought into it, and so we get what we expect. Oh, man, I'm comparing myself with that. I ain't comparing myself with that. The name of Jesus. I ain't comparing myself. I thought it was my other day. I got some radical stuff. So I want you to make a decision. You're going to be different. If you want the manifestations, you're going to have to be different. If everybody cool with your Christian life, you ain't being talked about. If you're not being talked about why, you know, she really serious. If you ain't being talked about, you need to be different. You ain't really stepping to different till you talked about. Why are they doing all that? Golly, she's so hard. He's so hard. Dr. Dev too hard. Pastor Ken love him, but Dr. Dev is hard. All right. Okay, I think that's enough. I think that's enough. Now, I don't care how old you are, you can still learn. I don't know why I'm saying that, but you can still learn. And you don't ever stop. You can stop going to school, but you can never stop learning. And I'm telling you, man, that we've been saved a long time, 30-something years. And the word to me now is like, it's becoming, it's so awesome, so rich. Like, it's almost like God is talking to me personally. Yes. I'm not just reading, but he's like talking to me. This is where I got all this. He said, I'll be a God to you. I'll be a God to you. So it doesn't matter what it looks like. I'm God all by myself. I want to pray. And when we pray, you know, and if you can adopt this attitude, when we pray, we're not just like, okay, it's the thing you do to close a service, the thing you do to pray over your food. No. No, we're praying. We're talking to God. And we have access to the throne. And so things happen when we ask them. He said, you have not because you ask not. Father, we do thank you. We thank you for speaking to us. We thank you for bringing liberation to our hearts tonight. We thank you for showing yourself strong and showing us in your love letters to us what is possible for us. We ask you to forgive us for comparing ourselves amongst ourselves and not using the scripture as the standard for where you want us to go. You called each one of us individually. There's an individual plan you have for each one of us, and our standard is found in your word. So, Father, we prayed tonight for the, as we prayed in the pre-service prayer, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation to be manifested in our heart tonight. Before we leave this building, God, we thank you that better is possible. We thank you that you'll never leave us. Those of us that are in the midst of situations, we thank you. We came here tonight to understand that you're still there. Even in the furnace, you're still there. We thank you for that, Father, that you never sleep nor slumber. So you're working on stuff. You're active behind the scenes while we're sleeping and renewing our strength. Father, we thank you tonight that no weapon formed against us can prosper because you're our shield and our fortress and our God. Father, we thank you everything that we thought we lost in our lives, that you are the restorer and you are a God of reversals and you are a God of reconciliation. We thank you for that. So we don't have to blame people for our problems. We don't have to create a tangible devil to point at to say that's why I'm like I am. I rebuke that spirit right now and I just release the spirit of a conqueror. Listen, we conquer everything that comes at it. All the works of the enemy is under our feet right now. So Father, we do thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. If I have anybody in here tonight who said I'm going to be different. In fact, let's if you would please, let's all stand. Let's all stand, please.